July lecture in terms of attendance, and tribute to tonight's speaker, Professor Opat, who is the Professor of Experimental Physics here in the School of Physics at the University of Melbourne. I have had the privilege of being one of Professor Opat's students a long time ago in a whole variety of different subjects, quantum mechanics and relativity, some of the topics of tonight's lecture. And later on, he came down and issued some guidance on some experiments I was devising for surgery of students involved in the New Zealand project. Came down without a notebook or a textbook or anything, and proceeded to derive from first principles, from memory, the theory for the experimental results of feeling in the laboratory. And that made a profound impression on me because to him, physics was absolutely real and every day. So it's a great pleasure for me tonight to introduce him to you, where he's going to talk about our never-ending fascination with gravity, the great attraction of physics.
Well, I'm somewhat embarrassed. If I'd known you were all coming, I would have prepared something. I came up with this title, The Great Attraction of Physics. It was just too good to miss for gravity, but fortunately the faculty put out a notice and they left out the word gravity, and it just was called The Great Attraction of Physics in their advertising, and that's true too. So I'm happy with that. Let me just say, I put down a wish list of things I'm going to intend to cover tonight. Some of the things I'll show you. Oh, sorry, I forgot to put them in. These are some of the topics. When I started to write it out and make some notes, I realised I hadn't got a chance of getting through any of this, so I did a recording, but this is the issue. Of course, everybody has different ideas of what attracted Einstein to have a look at the work of Newton, and here's the best cartoon I've seen. It apparently freezes by its chances now in. This is the best. There's another physicist called Ken Northbett. I don't know if I'll get around to mentioning his work tonight, but he's contributed very heavily to observational aspects of gravity. And I caught him walking around one day with an unbelievable t-shirt on. And here's Ken Northbett and his t-shirt. I couldn't resist taking a photo. I'd kill for that. I don't know where he got it. Okay, so let's start at the beginning with some very elementary things that people almost certainly know. The first law of Newton says that a body continues with constant velocity in a straight line if it is not subject to force. I mean, it was in Latin and it was a little bit different, but even this, I'll show you that. We have here what's called an air track, which gets rid of friction. And here we have an object which is very little friction, and it will move with essentially constant velocity. The fact that we're in a straight line is being published on our rail. the fact is that in 3D, we could do this, and of course we didn't go with so those are fascinating, it's a very important observation. And in fact, it was not obvious. It's a very important statement because all the people prior to Newton, possibly with the exception of Galileo, realized that you needed to shove things to make them go. And he pointed out, no, there's no force on them, not even friction, they go with constant velocity. Now, this law is manifesting nonsense in another sense, that if we carry out some exotic motion or even rotating or something, a body with no apparent forces on it, doesn't go in a straight line. So this statement actually is a backwards statement. It's actually said wrongly. What it should say is there exist frames in reference exist, which when bodies are not going go in a straight line. You can always find such a support device that seems to be around. Now, what I want to do now is to do the next door, and we'll get our air track running again. And what I want to do is to look. It's already been called for a minute, really. It's called for a I'm going to put a small book in there. Okay. And the thing is about gathering speed as it goes, okay? And let me improve this by taking the room on the seat. Use the color again. I'll do that once more. And I'll lose the four, look through one a little bit. And gather as speed as it goes, but we've got a four time. Okay, now I'm going to double the four, and it will go faster. And it goes much faster, the acceleration is much faster.
And that is the subject of the second law, which says that when you subject particle or thing to force, it gathers speed, that is to say, accelerates. There's another law which I won't be reading much tonight, and that is that if two bodies interact, they interact with equal and opposite forces. Now, Newton also went on to give us his universal law of gravity, which was really quite a surprise. He woke up to the fact that there was something, from his point of view, that was attracting things to the ground, this famous story about the apple and so on. And he woke up to the fact that there was this law of attraction which was called gravity, and he woke up to further that the force should go inversely as the square of the distance and be proportional to the power of the masses involved. So if you have two bits of matter, then they attract each other according to this result. And this G is a terribly small quantity. This is usually reinforced as follows, that you have an object like the sun, and it creates a gravitational field around it, which is given by Earth and space, we have a square there, and this force is the product of the mass you put in the field, multiplied by the strength of the field, and that's an attractive force of the field. And this theory, the first thing we did was to recognize the fact that the moon was in fact falling all the time. And I won't go through that story. And he calculated the rate of fall of the moon on the basis of this, and was surprised that he could it agreed with the rate of fall of stones on the Earth. I mean, quite a surprising fact to connect the two, and he was absolutely staggered. It had enormous predictive power, the gravity of Newton. First of all, to incredible accuracy, it predicted the motion of the planet to unbelievable accuracy. You practically need nothing else except Newton's theory today to give an account of the motion of the planet. It showed that they moved in ellipses, which had been discovered by Kepler. It showed that all the laws of Kepler that he discovered observationally at that point were immediately done. It explained the motion of the moon around the Earth, and also explained tides, which was covered. Why there are earth tides, tides in the ocean. Well, one of the things that was done, was very early, quite surprisingly early, was to measure the constants of gravity. And the currently accepted value of the constant of gravity is this number, 6.672 by 10 to the minus 11 units. And its accuracy is like 1 in 5,000 or 1 in 8,000 or something like that. And it's the worst known constant in the book. And there's been serious attempts to measure it, and it defies easy measurement. There's been a result just come out of Germany in the last 2 months, and this was the measurement to the end measurement. It was going to be so precise and so narrow, and they published, closing this unbelievably narrow error, and simultaneously another result from another high precision experiment, another high precision level, came out, and they lie outside each other, error bars by some significant number of standard deviations, and so the game is still up and running. And that is yet to be explained. To give you some idea, if you take a ton and then half a meter away, like this distance, you put a kilogram, the force on that kilogram weight is 27 micrograms weight. So imagine you have a microgram in your hand, pushing it down. That's, anyway, it turns out that in measuring gravity, the problem has never been measuring that small force. It's always turned out to be easy. And surprisingly easy, in spite of its smallness. And the problem is the most unbelievable thing. No one knows where the center of these spheres are. It sounds like an easy problem, and people can make these unbelievably beautiful spheres with very little accuracy, very little deviation from the shape of the sphere on the outside. They're a method of polishing objects to be truly spherical. But the problem is the density of the gun inside is not uniform, and the center of gravity doesn't exist at the center of the sphere. And so all that polishing is in vain. That's the problem. I'm personally interested in quantum methods of measuring G, and I'm not going to make that the topic of tonight, but there are possibilities of measuring it using molecular ideas. The original experiment, which note the date, is over 200 years ago, gave a surprisingly good value. It was done by Cavendish, it was a protocol from above. The experiment was seen from above. He had a rod, a wooden rod, with two little weights at the end, and two really great big weights sitting on each side of it. And these both attract these things and make it talk. And measured this and encountered all the experimental problems very, very early. And those experimental problems live on till today. The size of this rod is a little over this distance between my fingers, is over 2 meters. And at the turn of this century, there was another attempt to measure G by a person called Boys. And Boys woke up to the fact that the way to measure big G was to make the masses as small as you possibly can and the apparatus as tiny as you can, and make the forces therefore small as you can to measure it the most accurately. And he made his little bar, which was not over 2 meters, but his little bar is here and is 1.6 centimeters. And that has set the experimental idea since then. If any improved, and to study the scaling laws of the errors in gravity measurements, it turned out tiny apparatus and answer not big. And that set the tone ever since. And it was so hard to have two big balls attacking with two little masses that he had to separate them vertically. You see here they are separated vertically. So that was his trick to getting around the problem. And here ran into another class of problems that no one on earth has ever encountered before. He sucked the air out of this apparatus so that it was in vacuum. And I don't think you've ever seen in toy shop windows, they have a thing called a foot radiometer. A little blade that goes around in the sun. Well, he got into that trouble. And that comes from, he had better back and he wouldn't have had that. So it was a real struggle. Now, one of the nicest ways of doing business came out of, funnily enough, the Second World War isotope separation. And there was one of the ways to separate the isotope of uranium
was to make an enormous centrifuge. And the centrifuge was developed in the United States by Jesse Beans, who ended up after at the University of Virginia. And that group there became extremely interested in rotors of various sorts and bearings with very little friction. And here is the apparatus. There's a platform which can rotate about a vertical shaft, which is here, the platform. The platform has on it a fiber with a little bar dangling on the bottom, this little bar up here, and it has two balls on the table. And the two balls on the table are like this. Now, it turns out that this bar tries to twist this fiber extending on so that the little bar goes straight from one ball to the other. This is the effect of gravity between it and the line. And then, when it tries to do that, the light, which is comes from a light source sitting on this platform, shines on a little mirror, goes to a couple of photodiodes, which receive the signal and say, the mirror has turned, and what they then do is send a signal to a motor down here, which turns the platform, and the thing then goes back, and these balls now move, and in fact, there's no relative motion to this bar and the ball, because every time the bar moves, the balls are moved by the motor down below. So this is the cat chasing its tail problem. And so all you do is you go in one morning, stick it on, and you come back at lunchtime or in the evening, and this thing is going around faster and faster and faster, because every time the bar turns, the ball is turned by the motor, and then the little bar starts to turn again, and the ball starts speeding up, and it just gathers speed all day, and you measure the growth of speed, and you measure gravity, constant gravity through it. It turns out the miracle is you do not need to know the properties of this bar. They're irrelevant to the experiment and can be essentially left out. And so there's a whole lot of things you don't need to know in this method. Now, that's a little bit on the history of gravitation so far. Now, I want to shift to discuss forces which are called inertial forces. And there is a thing called an inertial frame of reference. And in an inertial frame of reference, which is a very important concept, if you take a ball and throw it, it will go with constant velocity in a straight line. If you take another object and throw it, it will go with constant velocity in a straight line. So imagine yourself drifting out and out of space and drop the rock and throw it. Maybe you're in an inertial frame, that's the test. Now, if you're not in such a frame, then the path of reversible control can be curved in the complicated motion to monitor. And those motions and paths, the deviation occurs due to things called inertial forces. And I want to spend a lot of time explaining to you what an inertial force is and demonstrating some of it tonight, because the great insight that gravity is another inertial force. It's not a force in the ordinary sense, but it's due to something else. Now, before you get those of you who have done physics at school, they remember that they told you, well, you know, these things are inertial forces, they're not really real. You know, you could get rid of them by going to the right frame, they're just pseudo forces. I'm going to take that too, that's absolute rubbish. But these inertial forces are real. And I want to show you a slight cartoon of somebody taking off in a rocket. And this is the normal position of somebody flat on their back. This is called the eyes in position. This position, which is on the belly, is called the eyes out position. And what I would like to ask you is that if somebody is prepared to describe so
something that's acting on the body in the eyes in or eyes out position, they seriously are talking about an ordinary damn force, and I refuse to give hard sentences about whether this force is real. So that's my contribution. Now, everybody knows that if you get into certain frames of reference, that forces appear. And if you go to a fun park and get into the rotor, here's a picture looking down from on top, and here's something plastic against, I'm not good at drawing, but you've got it. There's something plastic to the wall as the thing goes around. And from their point of view, they're just in a room that is stationary, and there's some weird force plastering them to the wall. And this force is called the centrifugal force. And it's very real. It's used for dragging the cream out of milk. It's used for all sorts of other things of that sort. General centrifugation. It is a very, very real force. And that person is in my room position will feel quite, quite pushed. I've done a micro demonstration of the same thing. Here's a rubber band. I'm going to stretch a rubber band using this force. And it's quite stretched. I don't know if you can see it, but it is in fact quite interesting. But the ball is actually, the rubber band is very stretched. It needs to stretch the rubber band longer than before. Okay, so that's the centrifugal force. Now, there is another force which is called the Coriolis force. And the Coriolis force depends on how fast this thing is going around. It's called an angular speed, omega. And this object is traveling. Imagine inside this room, it can walk from the airport of the station. And if you get an object in throw inside such a room, the object goes like this, doesn't go in a straight line. Now, in Paris, at the Design Museum, they have such a room. It's a sizable room, it's probably about 4 or 5 meters by 4 or 5 meters on a rotor. You go inside, they close the door, it's got furniture, the usual in the room, it's okay. And you can live your life in there and do experiments in there. And my wife is on the other side of the room, and one of the things they do is throw a tennis ball across the room to the wife or whatever. And the having taken physics one, I sort of woke up to the fact that this ball wasn't going to go straight across because no one else was succeeding. So I fired 1 meter next to her, and she could catch it, and everyone was amazed. But this is, so the ball goes like this. Now, if you're in such a frame, you have a thing called the Coriolis. Now we have a TV camera here, just up the top there, and we're switching it on, and there it is. It's looking down at a pendulum, and here's the pendulum. I'll just make it swing. It's pretty well seated on the back. I won't straighten up too much. And now, what I want to do is leave the pendulum. I just think it's a bit of a nightmare. That's the same. Now, what we'll do is we're going to rotate. in a magnetic field is switched. So if you're in this frame of reference, it's as if there was a sort of a magnetic field in the frame which was affecting you. Okay. Now, here I have an ordinary little compass. And let me just, I'll show it to you in the real world. The compass. Here is a magnet. And there we go. And there's the compass. That compass is lined up in the field of the little star on the tabletop here. Now, let me describe exactly what is going on. The physics is the following. When a charged particle moves in a magnetic field, it feels a sideways force. So there's a magnetic field there because I put the bar magnet. What's in the compass needle is a vast number of electrons all lined up with the tail, all going around in circles like this. That's what they're doing. And that makes solenoid, if you like, or a bar magnet, if you don't have to drive it with a battery. That's the beauty of the process, if you don't have to have the battery still forever. And like now Tom Price is a very great one of them. And so they all go around like this in one direction. And so this tells you that if you take rotating charge, which is hidden inside that needle, put it in a magnetic field, it lines up. So if I turn the field, if I turn the, let me try so again, it's a little bit uneven. Here is the magnetic field. If I reverse the magnetic field, it will be in the same direction. Now, you can do this with matter. You can allow it. Here is a picture here is the expression for the Coriolis force. It consists of the velocity multiplied by the angle, the rate of rotation of the frame of reference that you're in, multiplied by twice the mass. And if you have a charged particle in the magnetic field, the force on it is at right angles, like the Coriolis force is, so it's proportional to the magnetic field, the velocity, and the charge. And you can see that 2 times the mass exactly hits the charge, and the angle of velocity is explained by the magnetic field. So here is a bar magnet lined up, the little string I showed you here, the magnetic field line. Here is the charge that's going around in a circle, and the solenoid inside the needle of the compass. And so here is a flywheel with matter that's going around in circles. And here is the matter of the charge going around here. Here I can create it with a flywheel with matter. If I rotate the frame of reference, that acts like a magnetic field, and this flywheel should line itself to that. So that's what I've got over here. Here I have a flywheel. I'm just going to put it in any old direction or any other particular direction. And I'm going to fill it up like this, and it's sitting in the frame of reference. Now imagine this is the Earth, and the Earth starts to rotate. And so the compass will now point to the Earth's pole, which is where it is. The tape went straight up in the other end, which is on the ship. Now you can, it just keeps focusing in some crazy direction, like this, in and up, and you make the Earth rotate, and it will point along the axis of the pole. That's for the gyro. Now if you don't believe me, I'm going to make the North Pole go down there, because my rotation will be in the opposite. And the wheel is in short fiber and it's going the other way. So the little pole is down there. That is a gyro compass, and it is identical to a magnetic compass, except it works on rotating matter. Instead of charge, it works on the rotation of velocity instead of the magnetic field. And this compass is carrying the extra up, here it comes because the gyro is working so good. Gyro compass is globalized upon rivers and there's a lot of lumps in the water. Ships are bigger ones, and smaller are bigger ones. They rotate like crazy, they rely on the fact that the Earth has become a rotating world, and the two wheels rotate only once a day, but they will cut for it by spinning the two much faster than all these Earth. And so it turns out to be the product of the two rotations of the Earth in the point. And so that's what's true. There's nothing to do with magnetic reference, it's coming along the axis the Coriolis force. Now, the so what I want to say is this, that inertial forces are as real as any other force. There exist frames of reference called inertial frames in which they vanish. You can find frames of reference where these forces vanish. You can also find frames of reference incidentally when magnetic forces vanish. If you have a charge moving along, and you've been moving to a frame of reference in which the charge is at rest, it is no longer moving through a magnetic field and there are no magnetic forces. So by picking them, you can get rid of magnetic forces by choosing a frame. Inertial forces, by choosing the right frame, you can get rid of them too. And there's one feature that I want to talk about now, which is that all inertial forces are strictly proportional to the mass of the object to which they apply. And that's a critical statement which I now want to talk about. Now, let's have a look at a thing which is called the principle of equivalence. And I've put a series of questions or statements. Are as real as any other? Okay? Well, you'd be weight, your weight is as real as any other. That's a gravitational force. Is there a frame in which they vanish? The answer is yes. Leap out the window and they all disappear. Okay? Mind you, this doesn't have to have too much force on it, but nevertheless, why are they going to they're gone? Okay. The other thing is, are they proportional to the mass? The answer is yes. So there we have three statements which are identical to the statements about inertial force. And the answer to these questions is yes, yes, and yes. And the answer is to one part in 10 to the 12th. And hopefully one part in 10 to the 17th before too long. Now, the problem, the question is, gravity is yet another inertial force. And that was Einstein's viewpoint, and he saw through that and realized that this type of, this very same type of force that we've been talking about before. And it's harder to see why the gravitational force should be an inertial force. Well, all I can say is you don't like gravity, hop out the window. I mean, you don't have to have it. And so it was like that. Now, of course, let's have a look at some more pictures of the situation. Here is the situation of somebody standing on the ground and they're throwing a ball, and you can see it's going much further. And here is somebody in a rocket, and they're going up at high speed, and they're doing the same experiment, and their ball is doing the same thing as the person in the ground. Here is a rocket with the engine off and out of space, and there somebody's throwing stones. And here it goes a continuous constant velocity in a straight line. And here is somebody that has been in a lift, which unfortunately the rope is broken. And while they're going to good, because they're so keen on physics, they actually throw an apple in this direction, and it goes with constant velocity in a straight line according to them in the lift. And so these two things are identical. These are inertial frames. Particles going with constant velocity in a straight line to test. And here it is when we have frames which are in some sense non-inertial and particles are not going to concentrate in a straight line. Well, of course, this was subject to enormous research. The earliest research, as you know, was carried out by somebody else. And further thoughts on the subject were had by Sir Isaac Newton. Here you're thinking about the law of gravity. Now, there have been a set of experiments which attempted to show that gravitational forces are strictly proportional to the mass. And there are the early alleged experiments of this question. Now, let me just Something that, because no one really understood what a vacuum was and there were no pumps, it took enormous imagination to understand this experiment, which is now so trivial that we have good vacuum pumps. Okay, this system. Okay, so let's just do it again with the vacuum in this, and they both come down here. Unfortunately, the so this is of Hawthorne's fall at the same rate. Now, the experiment, I won't go through it in this time, questions in later, but there was a very clever experiment done over a period of about 20 or 30 years in various steps and stages, done by a Hungarian count called Lutvish, and he verified to order 1/10 of the, there was a bit of dispute, but 1/10 of the 9 or so that all things fall at the same rate. There was, in the 60s, almost simultaneously in Moscow, Brzezinski did some work on very clever experiments on the rate of fall of objects, proving that they're all the same rate, and did it in the United States did the same, and that pushed the quality of the rate of objects to something like 1/10 to the 12th, which already makes it one of the most precise determinations in physics. And the way, so what's happening is, if the mass is the same on both sides of this equation, you can get rid of it, the acceleration doesn't depend on the mass. Now, I thought that this introduces an experiment that could be done later this year or early next year, and into the short-term future. I'm not going to go through the details, but the conception of a person called Warden, who is at Stanford University, and it's now become a consortium, and the name of the consortium is STEP, which is one of the acronyms I'm not going to work out, and it involves a huge group of people in Europe, plus Stanford, working on a principal experiment. Now the way this one works is you have in orbit around the Earth a tube, and this tube is it goes around like this, parallel to itself. If you do nothing, it's not turning. It is going around in a circular orbit, more a circular orbit, but staying parallel to itself. And so here's a tube going around in orbit, parallel to itself. And inside this tube is another piece of matter of a different kind. And if the matter and the tube fall to the Earth at a different rate, then let's say the tube falls faster than the matter inside it, then the tube will slide this way towards the Earth over the next point, and the fall will be at this end of the tube, and then over this side, it will fall to the Earth, as the tube will fall at a faster rate than the matter, and the matter will be at the other end of the tube. So what you'll see in the satellite is, if you're just up in the satellite, you'll see a ball oscillating inside a tube, just going backwards and forwards inside the tube, if all things don't fall at the same rate. And this oscillator has a 90-minute period, because that's how long it takes to get around the Earth in orbit. So this is the basic conception of the short experiment, and you believe it could post something like 1/10 to the 17 accuracy, which is unbelievable accuracy in any computer. But the whole theory of the conception of the way we look at space and space-time is dependent on this being true. And if it wasn't true, throw it out, Einstein would have to hide it in, you know, with his legend. So that's why this is being pushed so hard. I didn't tell you what the grease is that this thing slips on. this our country, an inner object, are both superconductive, and there's a magnetic field between them, and they slip on each other's magnetic fields. But magnetic fields can't penetrate superconductors. So that's very, very cool stuff, and goes like that. Now, tonight is not about special relativity, but I do want to mention a couple of facts. The first is that the energy and mass special relativity says not that energy and mass are inconvertible, that's what's often said, but it's a wrong statement. The statement is they are the same thing, and that the historic reason energy, what we used to call energy, what we used to call mass, grew up differently, a bit like the theory of Higgs, we had caloric and energy in the olden days, and then suddenly discovered a conversion constant between them, and then we scrapped caloric. And then this is the same sort of idea. We discovered that mass and energy are actually the same thing, and there's a historic factor still lying around the track called 2 squared, which happens to be 9 by 10 to the 16th in value. And thank God we haven't completely converted to energy. How much we're going to the butcher at the same time has 9 by 10 to the 16th joules of meat, thank you. however, that's what we mean when we apply a kilo. So energy and mass are the same thing. And what is going to enormous precision is that the source of gravity is energy and what you give it. Both what the physical for energy and the physical for mass is really attractive, and what's attractive is both energy and mass. And that is known to at least 10^9 or 10^10 this day. So energy and mass are attractive people. The other thing, and this will be crucial to an argument later on, no object can exceed the speed of light. It's another famous kind of special relativity. Now I want to tell you about a topological consequence of this. Imagine I'm standing here and something goes flashing and a sphere of light comes out here. It's a sphere and it's going out past the sphere of light, and I'm always somewhere in the middle of it. And I say, I'm trapped. I've got to get out of this. So I start running. And you can't escape, because to escape, you have to see the sphere of light. You can see the sphere of light. And that's what relativity says is not possible. So here's somebody trying to escape the trap of a pulse of light that doesn't go off. And it's a very salutary thought that you're always contained in your own light. Okay. Right. Here is, now Einstein, then on the assumption that mass and energy were the same, and the theory of special relativity is correct, and the principle of equivalence is correct, developed this thing called general relativity. And here is just a major bit of a summary. Mass and energy is the source of gravity. This includes matter, which you normally call matter and heat. Electrical energy, heat, gravitational energy, any form of energy is great. Principle of equivalence, all things accelerate at the same rate. That's the weak form, the so-called weak form. That's what I've talked about before. But there's a stronger statement called the strong form. It says nothing to distinguish between inertia and gravitational effects. And this has been subject to rigorous test too. There's no difference between optics or electricity, not just the fact of bodies under gravity, which can detect the difference between inertia and gravity. And finally, in the course of getting into theory, you find out the theory has the following characteristics. To include gravitational forces as inertial forces, a new geometry is based on inertia. And that is the hard part, because it takes place in mass. The other thing is that mass and energy is affected by the geometry of space-time. So the geometry that something's in is affects the mass and energy. Space-time is controlled So mass and energy affect the geometry of space-time. So the matter in the space controls the geometry, and the geometry controls the motion of matter and energy. So they interact, it's a two-way street. And suddenly we have this interesting thing that matter and space are interacting and changing each other, and geometry is responsible, responsive in an interactive way with gravity. Now, let me just do a little here it is, just a model of some of the things I was saying. Here's the stretch jump thing. And from a certain point of view, this is going to turn out to be very quick. And as a matter of fact, the stiffness of this space, which is becoming increasingly understudied, which is actually the reason that the gravitational constant G is so small. It turns out the measure of how thin the space is. Plays a very beginning role in theory and a very troubling role. Now, here I'm going to put a bit of matter, heavy matter, in the space, which is flat, and it will create some surface. So it warps the space down, it warps the space down, and it's curved itself, so it seems to be curved. And the thing that I wanted to draw attention to, which I'll be coming back to later soon, is the space is going to increase by putting in our matter. What that means is what I made more. I have more space now than before I put the matter in. And this comes out of mathematics and all this. Matter increases in our compared to 2 vectors per minute. Now, if we put another object in the third space, it will go into orbit like this. And, here is something, just all the things in the third space. And that essentially is just the idea of how we can have third space and give rise to the chance the space and the objects are interacting.
Now, if somebody stops you in Collins Street and says, when you're out there on Friday night, did you see Einstein's equations? Yet the answer would be yes from now on, because here they are. So if you stop in constant terms, did you see Einstein's real equations? Have you seen the equations of motion? Did you see the effect of the method? Did you see the effect of sun on the geometry? The answer is yes. Okay. The reason for that is I wanted to prove to you that behind this chatterbox that's going on here and the chattering of people talking about gravity, there's some very serious hard work going on in the background. And it's to do with that and a lot more. Okay, now, here is a picture of my attempt to imagine in space we have an attractive center, let's say it's very small, and this, with the suppression of one of the spatial dimensions, is some sort of graphic of what I was showing you here, that the space is curved, and here is a couple of cars that are traveling along. Here's a photon wandering along, and it doesn't go near the piece of matter with the big stick and the hole, but it just goes nearby and it has a little deflection. But also, just by the way, because this surface has been bent and curved, it has a longer journey to go on than going along that journey, because there's more surface to go on. Apart from the fact it's deflected, it's also got a longer journey, because there's more space there. Here's another unfortunate particle, which is heading directly inwards, and it tears in and falls down here. It's still on the surface, but the surface drops down now. And, this surface, I'll come back to the point of the question, but this one thing I've been talking about. In relativity, mass always occurs multiplied by the Newton constant divided by the speed of light. And this gives mass, this new end, which is multiplied by these two constants, has dimensions of length, which are checked. So the mass of the sun, which I don't know what it is in kilos, but it's well known,
turns out when you do this, it was 1.5 centimeters. And the mass of the Earth is 4.43 millimeters in these units. And these are geometric lengths, and they measure the extent to which these masses are affecting the space around them. And you'll hear people constantly saying, relativists having a happy chat, saying the mass of the Sun is 1.5 centimeters. And the SI people should not listen. Anyway, this tube has a radius of 2 times the mass of the Sun, which is 3 kilometers. And that, of course, lies inside the material of the Sun and is not realized by the solar system because it's not compact enough. The Sun is not compact enough. Now, but this is the gist of the black hole, is the compact enough object, not that we're not only the material of the star first, but the one inside this continuing down at this, essentially at this radius of 3 kilometers forever, from the point of view of an outside observer, and that will be the state of that object. Now, I want to tell you about a calculation that was done by people who knew nothing about relativity in the last century and got it right. The calculation has to be right. And you ask the question, I have an attractive center here, a body for some mass, and I go with this in R away from the mass. It could be on the surface of it, or it could be up in the air, and then you're somewhere at some distance from the attraction gravity, and you get an object and you throw it up. And the question is, what velocity would you have to throw it up so that it would escape and never come back, but it would leave the attraction gravity to go forever? And that, of course, is when the kinetic energy of the object we throw up invisible, the potential energy change needed to get it to infinity. And when you deal with this, you can then say, well, it's the fastest, if I fire light up, which is turbulent at speed C, what radius from the mass will I have to fire up from so that it will escape? And this is the formula that comes out of the isometric calculation. And it's the answer to the sum and the sum of the cylinders. And so let's say it this way. Because the sun was so compact with the rock, it was just very tight perspective, so you could get 3 kilometers away from it. Then if you were further than 3 kilometers away, you shone a torch, the light would go up and escape to infinity. If you were below 3 kilometers from it, the attraction is such that the light would go up and be pulled back because it is not fast enough to escape. The spirit of that is still true in relativity. Now we have to tell you a story. If you imagine now that you have, you're there, here's this surface, you've got a point sun, you're less than 3 kilometers away, and I let off a flash, and light travels out from me in all directions. Instantly, I've got nothing that's important to happen before, but that's the side effect. I let off the light. Light goes out in a flash, and what we know is none of that light can escape from the star, from the because it's inside 3 kilometers, and even the stuff going upwards, doesn't escape from the star because it's going to fall back. But I can't go faster than the speed of light, and all this light, whether it goes out sideways, downwards, or upwards, is all going to go in, and I'm inside it. So you can come to your own conclusion about what's going to happen to you. If light can't make it, you're not going to, because you are captured according to the specificity of relativity by your own light emission. That's why I drew attention to that aspect of relativity before. And that is the gist of a black hole. That is why things can't escape from it. They would have, because light is pulling, you would have to beat the speed of light to get out. Okay, now's the time for a parable using a morally uplifting tale. It's the story of two fish. Now the rules of the game are that fish do not exceed or cannot swim faster than the speed of sound in water. This is a rule of fish. Not unlike now. There happens to be, this is like Niagara Falls, and the water is going over, and the mother fish says, never go near the edge of the beach, because the little fish. And you see, here's the mother yelling, and telling this, and the little fish doesn't listen and goes past this point, some particular point on the waterfall. Now, when it goes past this point, the water is then slowly by speeding up a bit here, and at this point, the water is now falling faster than the speed of sound and water. And that's, there's no problem with that, because we still have water here. So the water is now going faster than the speed of sound and water. So this fish, which is coming down with it, it happens to be stationary with respect to the water. It's yelling blue murder because, but even the sound that goes backwards is not getting to its mother, because the sound that's going backwards is still coming with it, because the water it's in is going faster than the speed of sound. So it's incommunicado. It's rather because the hope of something coming with, but not the other way back, so it's lost forever. Now, it's very sad, I have to say, no, I don't. I usually have to handle the problem in the middle of the tail and wipe my eyes. But however, there's a couple of aspects to this story that I want to draw attention to. This is really a model of a black hole. This is really the black hole situation. Nicely modeled. It's a fish. There's several questions that you can ask. The question is, you can ask the fish, and I was just standing here asking the question, when you went through this region here, did you notice anything? I said, no, no, it's nothing. It was just a normal bit of water. I was basically in the water. It was all in the water. That's what water. And when I went through that line, so the edge of that hole is no special place in space. You could slip past it and not know. It's just that having done it, you're incommunicado. And so, now there's a separate question, are there rocks below it? In other words, having gone inside a black hole, is there anything else going to happen to you? And the answer is yes, it's certain. Okay, so that's the end of that. Okay, now, the theory, that's what a black hole is. Now, the theory has been tested, and I wanted to just finish up by telling you about some of the tests, old and new. And I'm going to be very quick with them. According to the theory, if you fire light up against the gravitational field, so you fire from low gravitational potential to a high gravitational potential, such as up a multi-story building, and this has been done, then if you launch blue light here, the light up here will be slightly red, and move towards the red end of the spectrum. This experiment has been done. The spectral shift has been seen up here, and light has been down here, shifted to the left. And this measures the truth of this formula predicted by relativity, that the light going up in this gradient is redshifted, and it's redshifted to about, the verification is at about the 1%, maybe it's a bit more than that. It was actually done with X-rays, using the for the most part. It wasn't done with visible light. The second thing has been done with visible light, using the natural sun, but light coming from the sun, it starts off blue and ends up a bit redder at the Earth because it has to climb up out of the gravity of the sun to go to the Earth. And it turns out that this is only of order 10 or 5% accuracy, this, because unfortunately the light that comes out of the sun is molested by turbulence and pressure on the surface of the sun, and it doesn't come out as a nice spectral line to work with. But this prediction, redshift is low, well, it's certainly true. Here is two stars in the sky. You see two stars, and you measure the angle between them. Now, if the sun moves close to the path of one of the stars, so at a certain time of the year, the light coming from one of the stars just happens to skirt the disk of the sun, and the convenient time to look at this is where somebody has been moving the movement from the sun so it doesn't dazzle you. That's the way they do it during the eclipse. And so this, so here's the sun here, and here's the light from the star, and the light from the star has to go into orbit around the sun, have a little bend as it goes, it's pulled in, and the effect of this is that the ray of light coming from this star, as it sways as the sun, comes in as shown, and if you draw a straight line back to the moon, you see it with your eye at this point, it seems to move closer to this star or move further away from the apparent position of the sun. And this is again well known and been determined, and it's very historic significance. the angle expected for the deflection according to the theory is given by the mass of the sun, the radius of the sun, and some other stuff, and it comes out as 1.7 by 1 second of arc, and the measured value is 1.73 plus or minus about 0.5. And that we looked at on time to time. Just for the record, a very important subject, which is part of the research of this department, we have an astrophysics group, is a thing called gravity lenses. It turns out that because an attracting mass like this, it acts as a lens. It deflects light inwards, like a lens does. And one of the main tools for looking at unseen matter in the universe is not only the reflection of light. What happens is that quasar here from the light source on the other side of the universe, and you're looking at it, and something moves in between, and you see the thing image in a complicated way by the object passing in between. And objects are discovered this way, and measured their mass this way, and other things, and Rachel Webster is doing some of this in this department. So gravity lenses become extension, bring something to verify relativity to a major tool of that sort of thing. Another thing is a thing called the precession of the orbit. Now, according to Newton, and as observed by Kepler, planets move in the elliptical orbit around the sun. But according to general relativity, there's a slight modification, and the best way to think of it is the planet continues to go around in an elliptical orbit, except the elliptical orbit moves around a little bit very, very slowly, extremely slowly. So at the beginning of the century, the planet is doing this, and later in the century, it's going like that. And this, I've tried to sketch it, not very successfully, and this closest point of approach moves around, and it's called the advanced perihelion. And this was measured in the last century, long before there was any general theory of relativity, and it came out as 40 feet from Earth to the second of our century. It's not exactly a big angle, but it's moving. And the measured value of it is 40.11 plus or minus 0.45 seconds apart per century, which is a remarkable premium in the prediction of the theory. Another thing that convinces us that general relativity is true. Einstein was actually asked the question, what would you have said if these two numbers didn't agree? And he said, I would have felt sorry for God. So a famous reply. Meant that God had missed the opportunity to make a simple physical theory. There is a two objects in the sky. Most stars occur in pairs, and not singles, but they're so close together you see them as singles. And these pairs are going around each other in orbit. And there's one particular pair where one member of the pair is a so-called pulsar, which means it carries its own clock. And this. You can see these precessory on each other because the world is known pulsar moment form of system. It's one of the most studied objects in the whole of astronomy, this pair of stars. It's an absolute. The story of this got a Nobel Prize, this particular thing. But in particular, this perihelion here, these two stars being around each other, the only one is a planet and the other is the center, goes as 4 degrees per year, not 42 seconds of arc per century. By 4 degrees per year. So this thing has been studied now for 15, 20 years. You can multiply that by 4, and it was once like this, and it's now like that. It's, you just do it with an ordinary, you get the picture, you do it with an ordinary ruler and compass, you don't need to attract it. I mean, it's really such a big precession. And the story of why this agrees with general relativity is a very complicated one. But the answer is it does to prodigious accuracy. It's a complicated story and it needs a long time to tell. Now, there is another prediction, which I tried to indicate from this down here, that when you put a weight on flat space, the amount of space is increased. And this says the following thing. Here is a picture of Venus in orbit around the sun and the Earth in orbit around the sun. And Shapiro and his group decided to measure the distance between the Earth and Venus by bouncing
radar signals back and forth. They take several hours to go back and forth. But they go back and forth, and you do this every day of the year, through the year, and sometime of the year, the radar signal raises the edge of the sun. And in the neighborhood of the sun, the mass of the sun has created a lot more space. So instead of the bungalow just being some smooth ground, which just depends on how these two planets drift away from each other in the course of the year, when the rays get close to the sun, the time suddenly increases because just a little bit to the sun, there's a hell of a lot more space for this light to go through. It takes longer to get there. Suddenly there's an increase. And this graph is predicted by the theory of general relativity, and here are the measurements of Shapiro. The graph is the prediction, and the data points for the pungalow are shown on the graph. It's hard to believe that this was produced by a bunch of monkeys driven over cardboard. Okay, the famous quote. Now, there is another object, which is a binary pulsar, which was studied by a fourth year student in this department. And it's saying, here's one star, and here's another star, and this star is giving off pulses to come down to the Earth. And it's in orbit around the other one. Now, when the thing is in this sort of orbital position, the pulses coming to the Earth come past this other star. They have to go past the edge of the other star. And so they have a lot more space to barrel through, and they take longer to get to the Earth. And so the student's name is Rachel Mendham, which is her fourth year project, and she measures the extra bit of space, the time delay, and the pulsar signals as they cross and head to cross the path to the other one. This is the theory, these are her points, and these are the things that are true, but there's absolutely no doubt that's a verification. It's one of the nicest fourth year projects I know. It's just absolutely beautiful. To take the data from the signals from the pulsar, and get to this. Now, the thing that I haven't told you is that you can ask just how different is this hunk of space from the sort of space that we have in this room, which pretty well to about 1×10⁹ base Pythagoras' theorem. The answer is Pythagoras' theorem has a 40% error. In this piece of space. And that is just how compact this star is and how much bending of space and curvature and increasing space is occurring in this neighborhood. And so I always regard this as a much remarkable piece of work. Now I can see I've gone over time and I don't have much more to tell you, and I think I'll stop at that point. Yes. Now, let me just explain. You've got these two balls and you've got this little stick there, right? The stick is on a form of rotating platform, and this stick, let's imagine the platform station. So the stick starts to turn like this. Hang on a string, which is mounted on the same platform. Not the same. The friction system, very low friction, it's mounted with a platform, a thing with a string hanging down, coming from the same platform, little bar, and two balls.
the little stick tries to turn into line with the two books. The moment it does that, an optical reader picks this up and turns the force away from it. So it never actually changes its angle. It tries to, but it doesn't, because every time it attempts to, the board moves. And so it's a servo control to maintain its angle. And if you think about it, it has to do a little increase in velocity to do the first, to stop it turning the first time. And the next time it adds a velocity to stop it getting on. And gradually, in the course of the day, this thing starts to gather speed, gathers rotation. And it takes a quarter, half a day to get up to the size of this thing. I mean, really, that is one of the methods that's being used. The speaker actually goes linearly with time. Yes, it's linear with time. Yes. Straight line. And in fact, they measure the slope. And that's where they get used to. Willfully suppressed. There is. Okay, let me just explain that. There was a diagram I showed which is central to which shows somebody on the earth and somebody in the rocket with the same gravitational effect. But let me just talk about the thing. Imagine we have a whole life of the center of the earth. Okay? So the inner loop is going to go the whole way. And you can go out the other side for like this. You can go right through the whole life. So the loop is going right through. So here's the loop. Okay? Here's our physical loop. No, they are in terms of different variables, but they're just different forms of the same stuff. That's well, on that subject, let me just tell you a little bit. If you take uranium, or a heavy atom, could be gold, it is converted to lead, but up near the top of the pure state. It's at the surface of the nucleus, there's an unbelievably strong electric field coming, very, very strong. And if you add up all the energy of the electric field, just based on the theory of the energy of the capacitor, that you do in first year physics, you find that the energy there is equivalent to the mass of one proton, almost exactly. It's an accident, but it happens to be equal to the mass of a proton. And so when you take a mass spectrograph and you measure the mass of the uranium nucleus, this one proton's worth of mass is this is measured in the collision of the mass of the nucleus. So it's kind of automatic. So anything that's measuring mass and you've got this extra electrostatic energy. If gravity did not pull electrostatic energy down, as it pulls the rest of the energy down, so uranium would pull much more slowly by about 1 times 250 fold than any other matter, a light matter, a carbon matter. And of course, we know things fall equally to 1 times 250. So a 1 times 250 error would be 10 orders of magnitude error. It's enormous. And so we know 10 orders of magnitude electrostatic energy for the same way as nuclear power. So that's more common.
Okay.
Yeah.
This iPad is made available from copies of the Brotherhood. If you'd like to take it away for further study, it only $4 each. If you haven't done a physics degree, it's not too late. Please come in to the School of Physics, or perhaps enroll some of your students instead if you are late beyond it. Thank you again for coming, and thank you, Geoff, for a very interesting.
A warning to the fourth year students, could end up on the exam.
I noticed the gravity part.